What's up everyone, your boy Tapesh Kumar here and welcome to the cockpit tour of the Airbus A320. So in the last video, not the last video, 3-4 videos pehle, I made a cockpit tour of the Boeing 737. If you haven't seen that video, you can watch it here. Either of these two places you can watch the video. And that video is a complete in-depth tour of the Boeing 737 cockpit. So, and then I also asked you guys, which cockpit do you want to see next? And the majority of you said we want to see an Airbus A320. So well, here we are today and we'll have a look at the cockpit of an Airbus A320 in complete depth today. I'll also put in the description of the 360 degree cockpit view that I'm using today in the description. You guys can check it out. There's also all the airplane models from Airbus. So there's 220, 320, 380, 340, 350, sare cockpits hain. So you guys can go and check them out in the description. And now, let's get started. So welcome to the cockpit of an Airbus A320. So as you can see, the cockpit layout is pretty much the same as the Boeing 737. There is not much of a difference. You still have 6 screens out here in the front, same as the Boeing 737. However, the major difference is this area here is empty on both the sides because the Airbus does not use a control column for controlling the aircraft. It uses this stick here, which is known as the side stick, and this is used to control the aircraft in pitch and roll. However, we'll come to that later on. First, let's have a look at the screens. So as you can see, you have the primary flight display on the left hand side. This display here is called the navigation display. Same on the right hand side with the first officer. The outboard display is called the primary flight display and the inboard display is the navigation display. This here is the upper ECAM and this screen here is called the lower ECAM. Now these ECAM things are different on the Boeing and the 737. On the Airbus, these displays can show you a lot more information as compared to the 737. That information is something I'll probably discuss in some other video because it's just too much information. So let's start off now on the left hand side of the cockpit. So this little thing here is called the tiller. And just like the Boeing 737, the Airbus A320 also uses a tiller to control the nose wheel of the aircraft. So again, this tiller is used, it's rotated left and right. And then you can turn the aircraft correspondingly. Now the interesting thing is, it is also there on the right hand side. So as you can see, the tiller is present on the right hand side as well. The A320 provides the tiller on both the sides. If you remember from the 73 video, the tiller is only available on one side, on the captain's side, on the 73. It's optional on the other side. Moving back towards the left hand side, this stick here is used to control the aircraft in pitch and roll. Uses something known as a fly-by-wire system. A fly-by-wire system basically uses computers to operate the aircraft. So what happens on a conventional aircraft is, when you give an input on the control column, that input goes to hydraulic actuators or maybe even directly to the flight controls using steel wires. And that input is directly translated into motion of the aircraft. However, on a fly-by-wire system, whenever you move the side stick, the input first goes to a computer. The computer will analyze the input and then send out an output to the hydraulic actuators or to the flight controls. The computer in between is what is basically the fly-by-wire system. The computer in between is regulating your inputs. Now it has both its advantages as well as disadvantages. In normal operations, when the computer is working fine, it's a very good system. However, when that computer fails, then you have a lot of problems which happen. Moving further, this here, what you see here is the tray table, the famous tray table. This tray table is currently in the folded position. However, it can come out and then you can place your food on it or you can place your paperwork on it or whatever. These here at the bottom are the rudder pedals and the brake pedals. So just like the Boeing 737, the top part of these pedals work as the brakes and the bottom part is used to control the rudder. This space in between here is just to rest your legs. and so are these little things here. They come down and you can rest your legs on them. Moving on towards the right hand side of the aircraft, as you can see, everything is exactly the same. There are no differences on the first officer side. It is all the same. Now moving on to the front side of the aircraft. These four or five knobs here, they are used to control the brightness of the screens. Then the screens that we have already discussed. This little thing here has a very interesting name. It's called ISIS, you know, just like the terrorist organization. This thing is also called ISIS, and the ISIS is basically a standby instrument. So in case your main instruments have failed, we use this ISIS to fly the aircraft. Moving on to the right hand side, these three lights here indicate the position of the landing gear. So right now, three greens implies the landing gear is down and locked. These three buttons here are used to control the automatic braking on the aircraft. So the aircraft again has automatic brakes. So whenever you don't want to press the brakes on your own, you can always select automatic braking. As soon as the aircraft lands, or in case of a rejected takeoff, the automatic brakes will work on their own and stop the aircraft. This here is the switch which is used to control the anti-skid on the aircraft. So just like your car has ABS, which prevents the wheels from locking up when you brake very hard, same thing with the aircraft. On the aircraft, it's called the anti-skid. So whenever the wheels start to lock up because of excessive brake pressure, the brake pressure is released slightly and the wheels start to rotate again, and the stopping distance of the aircraft is reduced. This here is the clock for the aircraft. It also has a chronograph. And this little thing here is the landing gear lever. So when you put it down, the landing gear comes down. If you want to move the landing gear up, you just move the lever up. On the right hand side, it's all exactly the same. Again, the knobs for the brightness. And here you have the speaker. It's there on the left hand side as well. This is the speaker through which all the audio comes out. Moving up to the front left, these are the master caution lights. So whenever you have any failure on the aircraft, or any fire or any warning on the aircraft, these lights will light up, and they are exactly in front of your eyes. So they're always in your field of vision. So these lights will light up and they will tell you that, hey, something is wrong with the aircraft. This panel here is used to control what shows up on the screens below you. So this is basically your control panel for the displays. And this little panel here in the center is used to control the autopilots. Just like the Boeing 737 and just like majority of the airplanes, the A320 also has this autopilot panel. It's called the FCU, and it's there in the center front of the aircraft where both the pilots can access it. On the left hand side is the speed, the middle one is the heading, the right side is the altitude and the vertical speed of the aircraft. The knobs below them can be used to change the corresponding values. These two buttons are used to engage the autopilot, and this little button here is used to engage the auto thrust. Moving down towards the center pedestal of the aircraft, these two computers here are called the FMGS. Now basically these are just interaction or control pads for the FMGS. So FMGS is basically a computer on board the aircraft, which has quite a lot of data and is pretty important for the operation of the aircraft. So on those two computers, on those two little screens, we put in all of our performance data, all of our takeoff speeds, all of our weights, how much fuel we are carrying. We also put in all of our navigation data. So what airport are we taking off, what runway are we taking off, how do we plan to get from A to B. All the data is stored in the FMGS and we put it in using those two screens. Moving further back, this little panel here is for your communication. So you can set your communication frequencies here. So whenever you want to speak to the ATC, we do this using VHF frequencies. And those frequencies are set on those two little panels. There's one on the right hand side as well. This little panel here is for your audio control. So from here, you can control the audio which is coming into your headphones. For example, if you want to reduce the volume, or if you want to listen to some other radio, or if you want to speak to someone else, we can use this panel and control that. This is for your lighting, and this panel here is for the weather radar. So the aircraft has a weather radar. It shows you the weather which is in front of the aircraft, and that is controlled by using this little panel. Now here in the center is the very interesting part of the aircraft. These two little black things are the thrust levers, or the throttles as Airbus prefers to call them. These throttles can be moved forward or backward, and they can be used to adjust the thrust. Now the difference between a Boeing and an Airbus throttles is, on the Boeing, whenever the auto throttle or whenever the computer changes the thrust of the engines, the throttles will move. So we don't touch them. The auto thrust or the auto throttle will move the thrust levers as the engine thrust changes. On the Airbus, that does not happen. on the Airbus you have fixed gates. So you just put the throttle in a gate and the computer will continuously keep on changing the thrust depending on the requirements. However, the thrust levers or the throttles will not move forward and backwards on their own. They're just fixed in that gate. If you want to control the thrust manually, you can always move the thrust levers out of the gate and then move them forward and backward with your hand. These two wheels on the right and the left are the stabilizer trim wheels. They are used to trim the horizontal stabilizer of the aircraft. These buttons here are the engine cutout switches. So whenever you want to start or cut off the fuel to the engine, these two switches are used. And this is also used to start the aircraft. I'll probably make another video on how you start the aircraft engines and how you bring it to life. But these are the two switches which are used. Moving slightly backwards, we have a little stick here. This stick is used to control the speed brakes on the aircraft. So whenever you bring it backwards, the speed brakes come out and they produce more drag, which can either be used to stop the aircraft on the ground, or it can be used to slow the aircraft down or to increase your rate of descent. Moving further backwards, this little panel here is used to control the cockpit door and the video. So on the A320, you have a dedicated screen which is usually behind. So this is the screen which is used to see what is happening in the galley. So there are cameras installed in the galley, usually three cameras. And they give you a feed inside the cockpit of who you should be letting into the cockpit. So basically we look at this screen first, see who's standing outside on the cockpit door, and then you just open the door. This switch here is used to control the rudder trim. Trimming is a slightly complicated process. If I start telling you now, this video will become half an hour long. So maybe some other day. This rotatable switch here is for the parking brake. So just like your car has that handbrake which you pull up, you have this rotatable switch which you can rotate and set the parking brake. Moving on the right hand side, you have this weird flappy thing, and this is the controversial flap lever. So as you can see, currently it's in the up position or the flaps are zero. You can move it to 1, 2, 3 and full. These are the various flap positions available on the A320. This little thing here is the printer for the aircraft. On this, you can print out your messages from the ATC, you can print out the weather, or you can also print out some money from it. Can you? If you follow me on Instagram, some of you might have seen that story. It's a very interesting one. This panel here is for your ATC and your TCAS control, or basically your transponder control and your TCAS control. So you set our squawk codes here, we change the transponder settings using this panel. Transponder and squawk codes are slightly complicated things. Again, makes for one more very technical video, but this is the panel which is used. Okay, this phone that you see here is used to make passenger announcements. So in case you want to speak to the passengers, this phone can be used and it provides better quality for the audio which is going behind. This little red colored thing here is the emergency gravity gear extension. So whenever your landing gear does not work hydraulically, or the hydraulics have failed, or it's stuck in the up position, whatever has happened, you can lower the landing gear by using this lever. So basically it comes out and then you rotate it 3 times clockwise and the landing gear will fall down because of gravity. Moving up, I would like to show you something a little interesting, and that is these 3 dots that you see here. The center one is red and the outer ones are white. This is used to adjust the height of the seat. Now the cockpit seats are adjustable in height, and the height adjustment is very important for you to fly the aircraft, because if you're sitting too low, then you will not be able to see outside the cockpit window, and same when you're sitting too high. So your seating height has to be perfect. How do you get it perfect? By using these 3 balls. So basically you move your seat height up till the time you cannot see the red one, the red ball which is in the center. That should not be visible to your eyes. It should be hidden by the white ball. That means you're now sitting at the perfect position and your height is absolutely fine now. Moving on to the overhead panel of the aircraft. On the Airbus, as you can see, the main difference is on the Boeing, all your switches were movable. As in, you move the switch forward or backwards to turn the things on or off. On the Airbus, they use a lot of push buttons. So on the Airbus, whenever you want to turn something on or off, instead of moving a switch forward or backwards, you press buttons. So they are called push buttons. On the A320, the panel layout is very, very sorted. You have the most used switches out here in the front, right here. These are the most commonly used switches. the rarely used ones, we will be able to find them towards the back side here. So they've arranged the cockpit in a very nice and a very beautiful manner. Out here, these are all the lights on the aircraft. They are arranged in one single panel. This here is used to turn on or off the APU, which is the auxiliary power unit. On the right hand side, you again have a few light controls, which are basically for the interior of the aircraft. Here is your anti-icing system. So Airbus A320, just like the 737, has anti-ice. So it throws hot air on the engine lip and on the leading edge of the wing to prevent the ice from occurring. Here you have the probe and the window heat switch. This switch is used to control the heating of all the probes on the aircraft and also the cockpit windows. So you just have one single switch for all the probes and all the windows. Very convenient. On the right hand side, you have the manual pressurization control. So normally what happens is, whenever you're operating the aircraft normally, the pressurization is controlled automatically by the computers. You just have to put in your departure airport and your destination airport and your cruising flight level. The system will automatically calculate the pressurization profile for the entire flight. However, if the computer fails, there's multiple computers, then you can control the pressurization of the aircraft manually, and that is by using this panel. Now on this panel, you'll see this interesting switch which is labeled as ditching. Now ditching is when you land the aircraft on water. So whenever you land the airplane on water, you obviously do not want the water to get inside the aircraft. And that is if you successfully landed the aircraft. As a result, the Airbus has a dedicated ditching button. When you press this button, all the valves, all the holes on the outside of the aircraft, from where there are chances that the water might get into the aircraft, they all automatically close on the press of this one single button. Again, very good thinking. Moving further up, this here is the air conditioning panel. As you can see, it's labeled air conditioning. So this panel is used to control the flow from the air conditioning system of the aircraft. These three switches here are used to control the temperatures, and these switches are used to control where the air is coming from. Moving slightly upwards, you have the ELEC panel. So as you can see, it's labeled ELEC on both the sides. From here, you can control the various sources from where you can get power to the aircraft. Normally, when the engines are running, they are used to power up the electricals of the aircraft. However, we can also use the APU, we can also use the ground power supply, or you also have a RAT on board the aircraft. Now, RAT is a small fan which sticks out of the aircraft in non-normal situations. It rotates because of the airflow, and that produces electricity. That electricity is then used to supply the aircraft systems. So moving further up, as you can see, this is the fueling panel. You have these six buttons here, which are basically used to control the fuel pumps. These buttons are installed on the various tanks in the aircraft. The hydraulic panel is the one which is above it, and the hydraulic panel is used to control the hydraulics on the aircraft. Now, the Airbus has three hydraulic systems, blue, green, and yellow. All these three systems supply various components on the aircraft. And lastly, on the top, you have the fire extinguishing buttons. So in case there's a fire on either of the engines or the APU, you can try and extinguish it by using these buttons. So when you press these big, large, red colored buttons, which will be lighted up in case of a fire, a lot of things happen. They cut off the engine or the APU completely. There is no bleed, hydraulics, electricals, everything is cut off to the engine or the APU. And then you also have an agent button on the panel. When you press this agent button, the fire extinguishing agents are discharged either into the engine or into the APU. Moving on to the left hand side of the overhead panel, you have buttons for calling different people. So whenever you want to call the cabin crew, which button do we use? This forward button here. When you press this button, the forward crew answers. When you press this button, the aft crew will answer. When you want to call the engineer on the ground, we press this mech button and the engineer gets called. This here is to control the oxygen mask on the aircraft. This here is for the cockpit voice recorder. Now the cockpit voice recorder on the aircraft records everything which is going on in the cockpit in terms of sounds. This recorder can record for 2 hours. This panel here is for your GPWS. Now GPWS is a system on board the aircraft which cautions or warns the pilots when you're getting too close to the ground in an unsafe situation. Moving further up, you have the emergency electrical power panel. So this panel is used whenever the primary generators have failed. Moving up, you have the evac panel. On this panel, you basically can initiate the evacuation. So whenever on the ground something unsafe has happened and you need to evacuate the passengers immediately, this panel will help you out. And above that, you have the flight control panel. So ELAC-1, SEC-1 and FAC-1. These are various computers and they have very fancy names on the Airbus. And these computers can be turned on or off by using these switches. Here we have the ADIRS. Now ADIRS is basically an onboard system on the aircraft which measures the air data, that is the pitot pressure and the static pressure, and it also measures the current position of the aircraft. It's a very, very complicated system which uses ring laser gyros, and it calculates the accurate position of the aircraft without using any external aids. We have three of these on board the aircraft and they are controlled by this panel. Moving on to the right hand side, the bottom switch is the wiper control. Then you have the engine switches. This is basically to start the engines in an alternate way. So on the A320, the engine start is completely automatic. It's controlled by the FADEC, and that FADEC, in case it has some problems, if it's not getting some data, then you can start the engines manually. And if you want to start the engines manually, these are the buttons to be used. Moving up, you have the cargo smoke panel. So in case you have smoke in the cargo compartment, these buttons are to be used to discharge the extinguishers. Moving up, you again have the flight controls. This is basically the computers on the aircraft with their fancy names. And lastly, up here is another audio control panel, the one that we saw below for controlling the audio to the pilots. This panel is used for the person who is sitting behind in the cockpit. We also have a few switches here which are further backwards on the overhead panel. Now these are usually just lights and air conditioning vents, and these are used for the maintenance of the aircraft. These small little things here in the center are all circuit breakers. They are used to protect the aircraft equipment. So whenever something is happening with the computer which might damage it, the circuit breaker will pop out and it will open up the circuit. As a result, the instrument would be protected. Other things in the cockpit. On the left hand side, your oxygen masks are installed here underneath this panel. So in case of an emergency when the pilots need to breathe, the oxygen masks are installed inside in there. This is basically storage. You can put anything in here. Usually we put our coats and our ties and our hats inside in here. This here is the seat for an observer in the cockpit. So if you want to carry someone in the cockpit, you can always have them sitting here. On the right hand side, it's again pretty much the same. Here we have the fire extinguisher. The oxygen mask for the first officer is inside of this panel. We have four life vests on the aircraft and they are in this panel here behind the seats. On the back here, we again have a few circuit breakers which are used for protecting the equipment. And this here is the seat for the fourth observer. So in the cockpit, you can basically carry four people at any given point of time. This here is the cockpit door. And from the inside, it can be opened by just rotating this little thing. However, if you want to open it from outside, then the procedure is different. This panel here is a blowout panel. It can be opened from inside the cockpit, or in case of a rapid decompression, this panel will blow out and equalize the pressure. And that is all about the Airbus A320 cockpit. I hope you guys enjoyed the video. I hope you guys got to learn something new. I'm sorry if you guys can hear a lot of background noise because it's raining outside and I can't really help it. And thank you so much for watching. If you like the content, please do subscribe to the channel. If you think it's good, give it a thumbs up. Drop in a comment below on how you like the video. Also, if you guys would like me to tour on some other cockpit, please do let me know in the comments below. And thank you so much for watching. I'll see you guys in the next one.